but it won't prosper. When darkness rolls, it won't breathe in. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh yeah, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs.
What's going on, everybody? Pastor Sean from the East Liberty Campus here. Just wanted to share with you some thoughts I've been thinking about hungering and thirsting after Jesus. I want to read a text to you real briefly, but it's Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount, one of the greatest sermons that it was ever preached. And I believe there's a group of people that are just surrounding Jesus, and this is where we get the Beatitudes. And I want to pull one of those Beatitudes out right now in Matthew chapter 5, verse 6. It says this: "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied or filled." Jesus is talking about a physical hunger here, but I believe that he's also talking about a spiritual hunger here too. That I know when I'm hungry, what do? I eat. And my favorite food is meatballs. So in the chat box right now, I want you to write down your favorite foods. Could be ice cream, could be chips and dip, could be salmon, could be salad, whatever it is. I want you to think about your favorite food and write that down in there. All right? Okay, you got it written down. So mine is meatballs. But I believe Jesus is talking about a spiritual hunger here, and that we all have a hunger and a yearning for God deep down inside. And I know physically when I'm hungry, what do? I eat. And my physical hunger has a voice. It's a growl. You ever have your stomach rubbing your backbone? You're really hungry. I know I've done that before. And what do? I go eat. And I want to make this statement here. In the natural, you're hungry by not eating, right? But in the spiritual, you create hunger by eating. I think that's a powerful thing. The more I eat of Jesus, the more I want of him. And I remember one time I was at a Chinese buffet. How many like Chinese buffets out there? They're really good. I was with my friend, and we were going, it's $5 to eat at the Chinese buffet, and we were just going to town. We were just piling our plates full. I got chicken, I had rice, I had all the things that I needed that I was going to eat. And then I went back up, and then I went back down. I went back up, and I went back down. How many know I could eat as much as I want at the Chinese buffet? As I was sitting there thinking, I felt like God speak to my heart that he's just like that. The more I want of God is I can keep going up and keep going up and keep going up. And how many know Jesus paid the price for me and I can keep eating as much as I need from Jesus. Jesus is just like that Chinese buffet. I can keep going up. I can pile grace on there, and I can pile love on there, and I can pile peace on there. Whatever I need from God, I can keep going to him and I can fulfill that hunger when I'm spending time with God. I want to pull up a verse in Mark chapter 7. And there's a moment here. There's a woman that is going to talk to Jesus. And it says this in Mark chapter 7, verses 24 through 26. It says this, "Then Jesus left Galilee and went north to the region of Tyre. He didn't want anyone to know which house he was staying in, but he couldn't keep it a secret." Verse 25 says, "Right away, a woman who had heard about him came and fell at his feet. Her little girl was possessed by an evil spirit." In verse 26, it says, "And she begged him to cast out the demon for her daughter, since she was a Gentile and born in Syrian Phoenicia." And I just think right now, this is a moment that this woman is creating hunger. She's desperate. She's begging, and she hears about Jesus. And she says, "You know what? You're not going to keep the secret." She falls down at his feet and says, "I want to get this darkness out of my daughter." As we keep reading in this verse, in verse 27 through 30, Jesus told her, he says, "First, I should feed the children, my own family, the Jews. It isn't right to take food from the children and throw it to the dogs." Wow. That's like a weird statement right there. Like, whoa, Jesus, what are you talking about? But verse 28, she replied, "That's true, Lord. But even the dogs under the table are allowed to eat the scraps from the children's plate." Verse 29 says, "Good answer." Wow. Jesus says back to her, "Good answer." And he said, "Now go home, for the demon has left your daughter." And when she arrived home, she found her little girl quietly in bed, and the demon was gone. That word in the Greek, "she replied," means she took a step towards. She went up to Jesus. And I don't know about you, but she was responding in hunger. When Jesus said that statement, I don't believe that he was trying to be rude to her. I think he was trying to spark something on the inside of her. I believe that we're all yearning and hungering for something. And she stepped back to Jesus and said, "No." This is what she said. And she said back to him that statement, "Even the dogs to get the scraps from the table." And I want to talk to you about five things about being hungry for God tonight. Number one, as we pull out this text, is stay humble at the feet of Jesus. I don't know about you, but this woman fell at the feet of Jesus, and she was humbled. And I know during this time, this is what I'm learning, that I got to stay humble, and I got to stay at the feet of Jesus. I want to stay there. I want to learn from him. I want to talk to him. And the Bible says in James 4:10, "Humble yourself before the Lord, and he will lift you up in due time." I want to stay humble. I want to get on my face before God, and I want to talk to Jesus during this time. I know right now, this season of my life, that we're never going to have this season again. We're never going to have another maybe pandemic again. But I know in my life right now, I want to take and seize this opportunity and say, you know what? Maybe God's given me an opportunity to spend time with him. I want to spend time with Jesus and talk to him and spend time in his word and spend time with worship and stay humble before God. And I'm asking all of you out there just to, you know what, there's a real hunger. There's a yearning on the inside of you to want more of Jesus during this time. I'm asking you to take time during the morning or take time during the night just to spend time with God. Take 5 minutes to read his word and take 5 minutes to worship and take 5 minutes to pray and watch what God does in your heart as you stay humble at the feet of Jesus, just like this woman did. Number two, step out in faith. This woman stepped out in faith. I mean, this woman was talking to Jesus. She was a rabbi. He was a rabbi, and women usually at that time were not allowed to go talk to rabbis. But she was so desperate. She needed a miracle, and she broke in and she fell at the feet of Jesus. And she said, "You know, my daughter is possessed by this evil, and I want you to please take it out of her." And she stepped out in faith. And the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:7, "For we live by believing and not by seeing." I think it's powerful to step out in faith during this time. So number one, I'm going to stay humble before God. But number two, I'm going to take a bold step of faith and ask God for some things that I'm not normally asking him for. I'm asking him for my city right now. I'm asking him for East Liberty right now, for me personally. I'm asking him for my kids. I'm doing things that I don't normally do. I'm believing God bigger. I'm asking God. I'm stepping out in faith and asking God and putting a demand on Jesus to do something now. I believe this is the greatest time for our church. I believe this is the greatest time for our city, that God right now is getting ready to do something in our area. Step out in faith. But number one, stay humble. Fall at the feet of Jesus. Begin to worship. Create a hunger. And then, you know what? Begin to step out in faith, just like this woman did. She stepped back at him and demand something from God. Number three, believe for greater things and better days. This is what I'm doing right now, is I'm believing for greater things and for better days. I'm believing for greater things and better days. I believe that what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to learn through this season of my life. Me and my wife, just the other day, we wrote down some things that we're learning during this time together. We wrote down 5 things that we're learning, and we're believing for greater things, and we're believing for better days, just like this woman was. She heard about Jesus. She fell down at his feet. She stayed humble. She stepped back, and she stepped out in faith, and she was believing for greater things, and she was believing for better days. What about you? What's the greater things that you can start believing for right now? What are the better days that you're believing for right now? I want you to start picturing that in your head. Just write it down in the chat box. Like, you know what? These are the greater things that I'm believing for. These are the better days that I'm believing for. I'm believing personally for greater things for our church. I believe that the revival is getting ready to break out in our church, at Bridge City Church. I believe when we get back together, there's going to be better days ahead of us. This is going to be a great time for our church to do something great for the kingdom of God. What about you? What about you? Just write down. Maybe talk to your husband or talk to your kids right now about, man, I'm believing for something big right now. Let's see what God can do, because in the midst of storms, in the midst of chaos, God is getting ready to show up. God is getting ready to show up in the middle of your storm. I love Jesus, and I love that about him. And this woman did that. She was believing for greater things and for better days. Number four, what did she do? She made her request known to God. And that's what we got to do. We got to stay humble. We got to step out in faith. We're going to believe for greater days and greater things. And then we're going to begin to make our requests known to God. Mark 11, chapter 24 says this, "I tell you, you can pray for anything, and if you believe that you received it, it will be yours." What a powerful verse that is. I'm going to make my request known to God. And I believe we can do that. I believe God wants us to communicate to him. God wants us to speak to him. Say, "God, you know what? I have these needs in my life. I'm going through these certain things in my life." And I believe when we talk to our Father, God talks back to us. I believe that he wants to hear your voice. Just like my son, and just like my daughter, when I wake up in the morning and they want to hear my voice, they say, "Dad, Dad, Dad." And I begin to communicate with them. They want to hear my voice, and I want to hear their voice. I believe that we can make our requests known to God, and we can begin to speak to God and talk to him about the things that are on our hearts. What about you? Maybe talk to your neighbor right now, or talk to your friend right now, or write down in your chat box, like, what do you believe in God for right now? Make your requests known to God. And I love that verse, because it's a powerful verse. It says, "I tell you, you can pray for anything." Wow, what a powerful thing. It says, "If you believe that you received it, it will be yours." What a powerful verse that is. Just like that woman. Man, she fell down at Jesus' feet. she stepped back at him, and then she made her request known to Jesus. She said, "My daughter, she's suffering, and I want her to be free." She made her request known to God, and Jesus answered back to her. He said, "Great answer. What's your request right now? I believe that God wants to hear your heart." Yes, I know that God already knows everything, but sometimes it's so good to just communicate to God and tell him what's on your heart. So number one, we're going to stay humble before God. Number two, we're going to step out in great faith. Number three, we're going to believe for greater things and greater days. And number four, we're going to make our requests known to God. And number five, we're never going to give up. We're never going to give up. The Bible says in Romans chapter 8, verse 31, "What shall we say about such wonderful things as these? If God is for us, who can ever be against us?" Never give up. Keep pressing forward. Keep speaking the word of God. And this is what I want to talk to you about a little bit before we close tonight. I want you to get a couple verses on your heart. And I want you to say, you know what? I may not see my miracle right now. I may not see the thing in my life right now, but you never give up. You keep speaking that word over your life. You keep speaking that word over your situation. You keep speaking that word over your finances. You keep speaking that word over your kids. I'm telling you right now, something that Pastor Rick taught me a long time ago. One day he was talking, he said, "You know what? I don't have a word right now. I'm dry. Like, I need a word." And I was like, "What do you mean by that?" And he said, "I got to get a word." And I was like, "What do you mean? Like, what kind of word?" And he's just, what he's practiced is he gets a verse in the morning. He just meditates on that verse. And I thought, you know what? I need to start doing that. What's your word that you're standing on for every single day? It can be just one word. It could be one verse. But grab hold of the word of God and never give up. Like a bulldog, you bite into that thing and you never let go. Never give up. Begin to speak the word of God over your kids. Begin to speak the word of God over your situation. Begin to speak the word of God over your finances. Begin to speak the word of God over your church. Begin to speak the word of God over your neighborhood. Maybe you can get out and as you're walking down, up and down the street, you begin to speak the word of God over your city and over your community and over your neighbors and watch what God does. The Bible says in Jeremiah, chapter 1, verse 12, he says he's watching over his word to perform it. And I believe just like this woman, she never gave up. She was going to hold on to that thing until she seen her miracle. And when Jesus said that was a great answer, she went back and her daughter was healed. Never give up. So what are we going to do tonight? Number one, we're going to stay humble before the feet of Jesus. Number two, we're going to step out in great faith. Number three, we're going to believe for greater things and better days. Number four, we're going to believe with all of our hearts that we're going to make our requests known to God. And number five, we're never, ever going to give up. I'm so excited to see what God does in your life this week. Let me pray for you. Father, we thank you so much for Bridge City Church, and we thank you for what you're getting ready to do in their lives, Father God. I pray that a hunger and a thirst would be born in people's hearts, Father God, that, Lord God, that you would begin to answer prayers and answer requests, God. And we thank you for these moments that we get to share with you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.